What makes people want to give back? Why do some people have this amazing generosity of spirit? Ian Potter was obviously one of those people. He saw the foundation as an opportunity that he could give back to our society, a society that had enabled him to do well. Sir Ian placed great emphasis on the quality of the governance, on supporting outstanding organisations, and also on supporting young people. Every day, we meet people who are trying to make a difference. When I think about taking risk, innovation, I then think of many of our medical research grants. We have been supporting outstanding people in those medical institutions, hoping that the projects we're funding really might impact on people's lives. That is something Sir Ian wanted to do, make a difference to the community, bring about change.
Hey. She loves being in the water. She loves that feeling of lightness and being supported by the water. And just the fact that she's able to kick the board and have that feeling of being like other children is fantastic. So we love coming here, it's really good.
All right, do you want to turn around and face the rain?
She needs assistance, you know, getting dressed, putting on shoes, trying to do her hair, getting up on the bench. I worry every day when I'm at work about getting a phone call because, you know, we've been around when Ruby's had these falls. You know, she's had black eyes, split head. I find it hard when I take them to school and I see other kids running around. All those things that your normal seven-year-old can do, she can't do.
My one is bubblegum.
We've had nerve biopsies taken, we've had nerve conduction tests done, we've had quite a few tests that are not pretty. But at this stage, there's no answer. Everything comes back as a negative.
It's been a long, you know, 6, 7 years, test after test after test.
Ruby's mum and dad have gone through a really bleak period in the last few years. They've been uncertain about the diagnosis. They've gone through a whole host of tests. And for them, what personalised medicine does is offer them hope of certainty of diagnosis. Personalised medicine is really an opportunity to use the genetic information of an individual to help them in their diagnostic and treatment journey for a disease.
She's starting to say, why am I not like the others? Why do my legs not work? How long do I have to be in a wheelchair? For us, with the work that Dr. Hilton's doing, is just almost mind-boggling because it means that a simple blood test might be able to tell us the information we need within a matter of months rather than years,
yeah,
and put us on the road. We'll be there.
The Ian Potter Foundation, I think, were truly forward-looking in their support for this. Not only was it technology that had not been established in Melbourne, it was technology that was really at the cutting edge internationally. 15 years ago, or even 5 years ago, this sort of personalised medicine would have been seen as science fiction. Today, I could probably take an undergraduate from the University of Melbourne in their second or third year, give them a few hours of training, a few $100 in their pocket, and they could sequence their own human genome from a cheek swab.
It's going to change how we treat disease. It's showing that we want to put our funding where it truly changes people's lives.
One of the major impacts of personalised medicine is around cancer treatment. We can identify those 1, 2, 3, 5, 10 different genetic changes that are peculiar to your cancer and target those as efficiently as possible. And the beauty of that is we don't waste time with chemotherapies that are not going to work, and we can target the tumour in a way that minimises side effects. One of the real challenges we face as a nation is how can we allow the community as widely as possible to benefit from the advances that we are generating in medical research, but still allow the healthcare system to be as efficient as possible. And personalised medicine is one way of doing that.
I sometimes think we have no idea when a grant is made of that effect it's going to have 10, 20, 30 years later.
Personalised medicine really fits with the Potter mission, and that is to have an impact in society as quickly as possible. We want to expand in a way that benefits over the next 2 or 3 years hundreds of families, and within the next 5 to 10 years get it to the point where it is in routine clinical care, benefiting the entire Melbourne and, for some diseases, the Australian community. I think that would really repay the faith that the Governors and the Ian Potter Foundation have shown in us.
I was 11 when I came here. Before we came here, we didn't know exactly where we were going to be. You just get a form and you're like, oh, you've been accepted here, or you haven't been accepted, or everything just gets bounced back.
Australia's really had a very good record in migration, and I think there's a lot of support for refugees. But then the political debate around asylum seekers has kind of muddied the waters, so to speak. You know, there's some ugly tones to all that.
You know, growing up and being a teenager here wasn't easy because you didn't know exactly what to do. I'm trying to learn the culture, the English, everything else, and always being told you don't belong here. I mean, there's people that really accept you well, but then there's other people where you're just reminding you ever constantly that you're not. But I've gotten over that mentality of thinking that I don't belong here.
We're dealing with young people who've got multiple issues. They have talents and capabilities, but often they're not recognised. And given the traumatic circumstances from the homelands they've come growing up, the transition into work is incredibly challenging. The Social Studio is a really welcoming place. We're a cafe, a retail space, and a training space. It speaks the universal language of young people, which is fashion, food, and it's fun. But it's also an incredibly nurturing and learning environment. It's not about giving young people handouts. It's about building their skills and abilities so they can participate and contribute in the full sense to Australian society. We're in the business of empowerment.
I've always loved fashion. I mean, even back home when I was in Sudan, when I used to just like draw up heaps of stuff, like I sort of created my own world in my head. I didn't know you could actually do it as a job. The whole idea, the whole concept of the social studio really got me. Like, it's exactly what I wanted to do.
Innovation is one way that we are supporting projects that actually will make a difference to our community and can also lead social change. So they go hand in hand.
The Ian Potter grant has been a transfusion for the social studio, an establishment name married with an emerging group like ours. That's a powerful cocktail, isn't it? We wanted them to invest in our strategic plan and to fund us for 3 years to the tune of $180,000. You know, it's a vote of confidence in us.
We have made major multi-million-dollar grants, but sometimes those small grants can make such a difference. That ripple effect goes everywhere.
When you talk to a Tong, you know, and you've seen her 5 years ago, you can really see that she's grown here. She's such a confident person.
I went to Sydney a couple of months ago to do an internship with Willow, and that was just mind-blowing. If it wasn't for Social Studio, I probably would have not had the confidence to actually go out there and study what I love. It's like my safe place to try new things and not be judged, to capture everything that's in my head and sort of put it out there.
Her teaching that After Hours program shows that she's really putting back as well. She came here for something and now she's giving back something.
I want to make the Social Studio proud. I want to make everyone proud. We want to show them how we can adapt the culture but also show ourselves to everyone, you know? Thank you for believing in us and we will continue to grow.
The Ian Potter Foundation places faith in the outstanding people, the organisations, the ideas. We can come in early when ideas have just been formed.
until we find another planet, we're stuck here. It's time we started managing this country as if we're here to stay for good. And this project was a really critical step on that journey of learning how to live like Australians in this ancient old continent.
Bring back memories?
It certainly does. I don't know how many hours I've spent poring over these. That's what we started with. Back in 1983, we're at the tail end of one of the worst droughts in recorded history, and land degradation was very obvious. You had massive dust clouds rolling in over Melbourne. This part of the countryside was literally blowing away. There's the raw aerial photograph, and you can just count the live trees. It was a magnificent documentary on the ABC about land degradation in Australia, and it coincided with a meeting of the governors of the Potter Foundation. So over morning tea at one of their meetings, they found themselves all discussing the TV show that they had seen the night before. And one of the governors said, "Why don't we do something about that?" And it was pointed out to them by Carrick Chambers at Melbourne University that we didn't need more research. What we needed was practical demonstrations on farms of what could be done. Here, with the Potter Farmland Plan, essentially we were trying to reconstruct landscapes that would work for production, for economic livelihoods, but also for the sustainability of the landscape in the long term. I guess I still pinch myself that I even got this job as project manager of the Potter Farmland Plan. I was 24 with a $1 million philanthropic grant, which was unprecedented and unheard of at that time. We started transforming those farms by rethinking the whole farm layout. We had a massive works agenda. I forget how many hundreds of kilometres of fencing we had to construct, and a lot of revegetation, a lot of pasture work, and a lot of water supply work, and there were so many balls in the air at any one time. The Potter Foundation investment was crucial, and that $1 million investment literally transformed these farms in a very short period of time. But it didn't just make a difference on these farms. We had thousands of visitors through from all over Australia and other countries, and they could see for themselves what was happening on this land. And then that became a catalyst in turn for the National Land Care Program and for a complete rethink of what it means to be a good farmer.
One of the very important things with the Ian Potter Foundation's funding is how we use our funding to leverage government funding especially, but leverage funding from other foundations too.
I remember showing the head of the National Farmers Federation and the head of the Australian Conservation Foundation through here, and both of them said, "Wow, we've got to be scaling this up. How can we do more of this nationally?" And that led in part to the land care proposal we put to Bob Hawke in 1989, which led to a $340 million federal investment over a decade. And land care is now being adopted in 22 countries around the world.
When you look at the vision, the results in Australia with the land care program, that is what our funding is about.
The Potter Farmland Plan is one of those candles in the darkness that illuminate ways forward to help society deal with these big, complex challenges. Worldwide, you can't fix climate change, you can't address food security, you can't improve water security without involving agriculture. And we think we've got some of the answers here. So I think the governors of the Potter Foundation can be extremely confident that they sparked something way, way bigger than just changes on 15 demonstration farms here in Western Victoria. And that visionary, somewhat risky investment, you might say, has paid off handsomely.
If Ian Potter was here now, he would be very proud of what he started in 1964 and what it has achieved for people in our community. So the issues facing people over the next 50 years are going to be much more complex, but I have no doubt that the Foundation will continue to uphold the vision and the principles of Sir Ian Potter. One of my hopes for the future is that others will actually contribute to the Ian Potter Foundation, because the more resources we have, the more we're going to be able to do to fund organisations in every field and enable them to carry out projects that will touch people's lives.